None of us can.
The strangest success story is Murph. But does it surprise you? Not at all. This demographic is
why do you think the character's on the show? Yeah.
But I'm still astounded by that by that guy. Mm-hmm. The voice actor is so gifted. Yeah. Or maybe that's just a trick, but you know, he's just brilliant. I can do certain things with my voice, but there's no way I can do this in the middle of the... He just stops it, and he closes it, and he opens it, and he puts little bubbles. I mean, it's just astonishing. And the children love it. So what it is it's comic relief.
How are you?
As the proto-star is going through all kinds of darkness, right? And everybody's in peril. And the little children are watching this, and they get scared, and then Murph... And they get to laugh, you know, and it sort of breaks the tension. So it's very, very, that's the Hageman brothers. Smart.
Yeah.
Smart. The writing is really good.
Which is amazing, the difference between Voyager and then coming to this show. If you could talk about, like, was it like a shock, how different it was, or, you know, how did it feel, like, coming back and how different this show was from your original show?
Well, obviously. This is animation, as opposed to live action. So rigor, number one. I'm not getting up at 3:45 in the morning, right, to get to Paramount by 5. It's much easier to do voice acting. And in that way, I would say it's probably more free. There's a great confidence about going into a booth, a recording booth, just my headset. I do it all by myself. I don't have anybody acting with me. And those guys are on a Zoom from California. I can see them. And in front of me is the picture if I'm doing it to picture. And if it's a recent episode, I'm just recording it. But I find that it's terrific to just go into my own imagination. Almost closing my eyes, but not quite. And doing things with my voice to convey ideas and emotions and fears in very subtle ways that you can't do in live action because you don't have the time and you don't have the leisure. And somebody's going to say, cut, print, we're done, we're moving on. No, just give me one more. In the booth, I say to Kevin, I need another one, let's do another one. Let's do 4 in a row. Let me do 10 in a row, and we'll choose from this. So the possibilities are really endless, and therefore it's endlessly exciting. Yeah, it's great.
Do you ever turn the character off, or is she always living in there?
She lives. She lives. She has to. At this point in time, it's pretty crazy how significant she is to how many people. I mean, I'm just constantly surprised by it. I'm very surprised by the dialogue with the fans, which never seems to get dull or dull with it. It's never reduced. It's never mediocre. These are people who are very, really very hopeful. And most of them are very smart about science. So the conversation is truly about space and the future and what we have yet to do and why we are so really behind the eight ball on this thing, right? Look what's going on right now, you guys. It's quite serious. We're really delaying. NASA needs support. We've got to get moving. Because I'm afraid that Putin means business. So
you're playing two Janeways in a sense in this show, and I wonder how you differentiate the two. In the sense that we've got holographic Janeway, and then you've got Janeway who is more, in some ways more determined than we've ever seen her, in the sense that she's on this mission to find out what happened to the ship,
right.
Chakotay and everything. Is that in your mindset at all, in playing the two different
Janeways? It has to be. That's the job. I have to establish this distinction, stick to it.
Yeah.
And having done that, I have to deepen both. Right? So, with Hologram Janeway, I would say that there's a modulation in Admiral Janeway and Captain Janeway. I can do anything I like. And the voice then has a real power and a richness. I try to give it a real texture. I mean, the Admiral is at it. She knows exactly what the hell is going on, and it's red alert, and it's no, you know. And the Hologram Janeway has to just maintain a sense of real groundedness. And empathy. The kids have to listen. They have to listen, but she doesn't ever strong arm. Because as you know, if you're a father, I'm a mother of three, it doesn't work. Kids don't like that. So I'm negotiating with the kids as Hologram Janeway with a certain voice that the Admiral and the Captain don't need to. And that's the fun of it. Also, with Admiral, Vice Admiral Janeway in this whole arc with Chakotay, I've allowed myself to be incredibly vulnerable, vocally. Something I didn't even do as Catherine Janeway when Chakotay was imperiled. Do you know? But the thought that I am responsible for this and that I may have consigned him to oblivion forever, I can find this in my voice, and it's really, really, I had to stop once or twice. But it's really, I couldn't do that so much on the bridge. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Live action. Yeah. So it's fun.
Are you excited that he'll be coming back?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, it's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, legacy is part of it. Mm-hmm. Part of the richness, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely.
And part of the lesson. So I think that the Hegemans are going to maybe do a little bit more of that, but don't say I said that.
Those of us at this table knew Captain Janeway first, and the target demographic for the show are meeting Admiral Janeway first.
Right.
Hopefully, in 5-10 years, they'll be watching Voyager. How do you expect that experience to differ for them in seeing that character in a different order than existing Trek fans?
That might be a little confusing, but this is why the cross-generational conversation is so important and so novel.
Yeah.
The mother is going to tell the 7-year-old boy what is going to happen, what is missing, who Captain Janeway was, and why we're going with the Admiral. We're talking about time, right? We're talking about light years in some cases. So the mother is there to explain that. And that's why it's a very deep thing. It's almost like a secret. I hope that it becomes a secret. And I hope that it becomes a globally sort of passionate conversation between children and their parents and their parents. That's the point.
Janeway is such an iconic character, and as you mentioned a few minutes ago, such an important character. When the Hegemans approached you to be on the show, was it an instant yes to come back? Did you have to think about it for a little while?
The Hegemans didn't approach me.
Okay.
Well, Alex Kurtzman approached me. And as we all know, he is the man of the hour. I mean, a little bit of a wunderkind in here. He's very smart. He's assumed the full mantle of the franchise. When I got that phone call, I was momentarily on the back foot because I thought, oh my God, my investment in Janeway was so complete. To revisit this in an animated form is going to be less than satisfying, right? Would be my first thing. So I said, I'm delighted that you've asked me, and of course I'm honored and flattered, but let me think. So I went to some of my friends whose opinions I value, and they said, are you out of your mind? This is a no-brainer. This is the one demographic they should have approached 50 years ago. And you get to be the one?
Yes.
Absolutely. And then I thought, oh my God, of course, of course.
You know, in 2005, Star Trek with the end of Enterprise basically meant it went into indulgence, basically. We got the J.J. Abrams reboot and Alex Kurtzman, the first movies. And it really was dead for a long time. And all of a sudden, now we're in this period, though, where it's come roaring back. I know Star Trek has been with you all along, and never went away. But is it surprising to you at all that it is back as big as it is?
Yes.
And so many, okay, it is.
And I'm fascinated by it.
Yeah, me too.
I mean, there's a lot of Star Trek content, but it seems to be very good, doesn't it, by and large? But there also seems to be, and I don't know if this is apropos of the relative bleakness in the global landscape or not, but it raises one's hopes. It introduces promise again. It introduces the prime directive protocols, which are, I mean, they're Greek. Listen to each other, trust each other, right? The captain goes down with the ship. First is comradeship, right? Trust. I mean, these things are irreplaceable. So I think it's reflective of where we are.
So is the original series. I mean, that series roared to life because of what
was
going
on. Yes, but what era was that?
66 to 69. We had a lot of crazy stuff going on.
Yeah? But I don't think we've been, not since the Cold War, have we been now as so this is deeply troubling. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've got three nations on the verge of, that guy in North Korea needs to be. So I think that's why there's this resurgence. Also, there are so many wonderful actors. There are so many wonderful writers and creators. And you can say what you want about Kurtzman or leadership. He's reinvigorated it. He's willing to try to take risks. I mean, he's the one who brought an animated series. It was his idea.
It's brilliant.
It's just brilliant. And to do it with these creatures. These characters, you know what I mean?
You seem obsessed.
I am obsessed.
Oh, it's but gorgeous.
He knew enough to make them very different.
Yeah.
To make the whole stew very, very different. And then you introduce Hologram Janeway. And then it goes to Admiral. And it just, you know, it's really great storytelling.
Yeah. What do you...
No.
It's brought in new audience members too. Like my husband wasn't a Trekkie until Prodigy, which I was shocked. I come into the living room like, what are you watching? He's like, I'm watching Star Trek Prodigy.
Your husband?
Yeah, he's not.
Was he drinking at the time?
I don't know. He might have had a scotch. So.
Then there's this, which is also wonderful, isn't it? Bring the wine, baby. Yeah. Right. Prodigy's on. It's great.
Prodigy and Lower Decks, he loves. I mean, like...
Well, Lower Decks is very saucy,
yeah.
Witty.
See, he likes that, too.
Yeah,
so
it's fun.
Yeah.
But I think he's probably getting... I mean, it's just... It's brilliant sort of creation. They're doing... It's all so compelling.
The thing I think that's so wonderful about Prodigy, and this is actually true of the first animated series as well from the 70s, is that even though the target is children, they're not talking down to children.
That's right. Mm.
It lets them know that they can understand these concepts. And there are some difficult concepts in this show. There are some heavy scientific concepts in this show.
And I don't doubt for a moment that it will be confusing.
Yeah.
But the beauty of that of learning is just that.
Absolutely.
You know, the little mind. I did I just tell you that I just came back from Europe? Which is why I'm sounding a little stupid. I just got off the plane. So 2 weeks. You know, I met children in the Czech Republic and I met children in Vienna who speak five languages. They're five. And they're just hold on. And then they're going to the German and they're going they can just grab it all. So they might be like this in front of the TV. Then they assimilate, then they sleep on it. And then of course they always have a mother or a father to say, ask, why did that happen? When did she went there? And what did that mean? And if the parent is a good parent, it will be properly explained. And they'll get it. And then they'll get the next level. And pretty soon we've got scientists on our hands,
exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
And it stirs all of that up. What could be better? I mean, it doesn't pander.
No.
It says, come forward. That's what it says.
Is there an episode or season that you're most looking forward to fan seeing? I mean, a scene or episode?
There's an episode about Chakotay that's very good. That's full of every conceivable true emotion Janeway could ever have. It's deep dive into her guilt and her regret and her courage. What's going on?
They're bringing all the press and the people in for the video interviews.
How rude.
I think you should just stay here.
This is the middle of our conversation.
Show that
we're talking about. Yeah.
It's probably
where
your head is next.
So that's
may
it.
Or not, may or not have to be better.
I don't know the name of it or the number of it, but I can.
You're saying with children and reaching high, my daughter, we often turn to her because we started them in Doctor Who and things like that. And people said, they won't understand it, but they don't. So now they're trying to figure out how to get to that point in their brain and they connect the dots and they start thinking bigger.
Yeah.
But while we're watching this, I'll often turn to her. What happened? And she's like, oh, because, like, you know, I'm a overworked, you know,
journalist.
Distracted journalist, yes.
Right.
But she's like, Daddy, well, this, and she goes in and she understands.
It's astonishing, isn't it?
All right.
It's wonderful. I love it.
And they always have that little level of exasperation with you as an adult.
Yeah.